about revival for last several weeks, and all these times and various ones were talking from that perspective, you know, coming back to God and you know, restoring ourselves before the Lord. So last three Sundays we talk about different things. Last two Sundays we talk about different things about revival. We said revival is recognizing and responding to the love of God that we learn from Book of Hosea. Then we said revival is the Spirit of God bringing renewal to His people. We learned from Book of Haggai last week. Today we look into another working definition about what revival is. That we said during the course of this time, the revival is renewing our passion, or it is to going back to our first love. Revival is renewing our passion. We'll read scripture today from Book of Revelation, chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. The Book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible, chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. Let us read God's word as usual. Let us read it together as usual. Book of Revelation, chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. Let's read it together. To the angel of the church in Laodicea writes, "These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot or cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, 'I am rich, I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing.' But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salt to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Now this is the theme that we selected, or the God, Holy Spirit has given to us, to restore us unto himself. And I believe that we prayed earnestly, sincerely, that we will have a renewal in our heart. We will come back to God and we'll prioritize our life to serve him, to walk with him and do his will. And again, I just want to thank God and for his Holy Spirit and for each of you for your time and sacrifices, and especially those who spoke God's word so meaningfully, powerfully to all our lives. And we pray that everything that we have learned during this course of time, we will be able to apply into our lives also. Book of Revelation is the last book, and we are not going into the book at all. You know, but it is reading, sometimes it is scary, Book of Revelation. But it's very simple. I will tell the theme, what it is actually. This is what the theme of Book of Revelation: Jesus win at the end. It's as simple as it is. Jesus win at the end. So there are so many things some other time we can study from that book. And here we see that you know, Jesus writing to his churches. Actually, these are the epistles of Jesus, or we can say the letters of Jesus. Now, out of the New Testament, the majority of the book are in letter form. You know, out of the 27 books that we see, 21 of them are in letter form. There are 14 letters from Paul, 3 letters from John, 1 from James, 2 from Peter, you know, then Jude. You know, we see that all these letters that we see, it is letters. So, but we study all those letters, you know, we study, go through that. I believe that this is very, you know, crucial and important and meaningful letter, because this is the letter of Jesus to his church. And there are 7 churches that we see over there. There are actual 7 in their separate churches, not one church, the 7 churches under same denomination or anything. There are different 7 churches from Ephesus to Laodicea. There are 7 churches. There are actual churches that John is aware of, these churches, the writer of this book. and he is aware of these churches. And Jesus is writing. So this is the actual condition of the church that Jesus reveals. So this condition of the church is representative of any church maybe, or any, you know, area or any age or any time. We see that these churches is the representatives of all these churches that we can see. We can study this in a, you know, historical manner. We can study in a pastoral manner, and we can study in a practical way also. So we take the approach of learning this briefly in a practical way. Just take only one thought out of that and try to emphasize on that this morning. When we study that book of Revelation, we see that there are a lot of sevens that we see. Seven is the second perfect number. 12 is the other perfect number. Seven is the other perfect number that we see. So there are seven, you know, trumpets, seven churches, seven letters, seven lampstands, so many sevens that we see over here. So this letter also, we can study the pattern of this letter we see. This is the way it goes actually. There are seven things that we see in that letter. Number one that we see, there is an address to the angel of the church in that city. The angel of the church. So, or the messenger of the church, or the pastor, or the leader of that church. So the spiritual leader is responsible for the spiritual temperature of that church. Then now you know that why we become very serious about these things. Because we have to give an account to the master one day. You know, that is an important task that God has given to us. So this is a serious thing. So that is why we become serious also about God's kingdom, about discipline, you know, do things like that. So the address starts with to the angel. Then God and explaining who is writing it and giving different attributes of the author. Author is Christ himself. Here it says actually these are the words of the Amen, the faithful, true witness, the ruler of God's creation. You know, reminding in one way that these churches, who Christ is. We read in, you know, in each of these places that we see that there is an attribute of Christ that we see in different places. Then we see that the Holy Spirit is appreciating that they have done something good, something positive, that the Holy Spirit is reminding them. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. Remember that. When the Holy Spirit is work in us human beings, we always trying to find fault in people. You know, that's why we can find fault in everything actually. You know, and we are very good in that. But that is what human nature is. You know, we see negative always first. But the Holy Spirit is not only say the negative side actually, it always tell the positive also. So to many of these churches that we see, there is something positive. You are doing this, you are perseverance, you are doing good. You know, at the same time, bring the negative side also. That is the way it brings. So the Holy Spirit is not to condemn us anytime. It is always to convict us. So that is the work of the Holy Spirit. So it is not the condemnation is not come from the Holy Spirit. It is from the devil. But the Holy Spirit always convict us. So when God's Holy Spirit speak to our hearts, we know that there is a conviction. I want to do something about it. It is not to put you down and say that you will never go into make anything at all. That is what we see with the negative side of it. But the Holy Spirit always convict us. So that is the purpose of it. Then we see there is an accusation or there is an allegation that the Holy Spirit tells to these churches. Even though you are doing good, there is something bad, something wrong that is going also. Then it gives an advice. Do this, do that. So there is an advice that is given over there. And it was an appeal. It says that to those who have here, let them hear. It is our choice to respond to the Holy Spirit. You know, when the prophet Nathan went to David's house, you know, if David was the king, he could have even killed him actually. You know, that's what many people did. But he was willing to repent of his sin. And he said, I have sinned. He didn't ask him, who are you to tell me? Rather, he said, I have sinned. So that is our choice to respond to the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Then if you repent, if you take the advice and obey, there is a promise that comes. There is a assurance that comes. Those who overcome, you will eat. Those who overcome, you will sit. Those who overcome, I will give you the crown. Now there is a promise that God gives also. That is a pattern of that letters that we see over here. So here we see that every letter, every chapter 2 onwards that we see, there are seven churches as we said. Look at that, each of these churches. You know, the first church we call Ephesus Church. That was a church was pastored by Timothy and Paul and the great apostles. But there it says that they lost their first love. That was a careless church. Ephesus was a careless church. Smyrna is the next church that we see in chapter 2, verse 8. It says it was a persecuted church. It was a crushed church. It is interesting to notice that there was no rebuke to that church. There is only two churches, Philadelphia and Smyrna. Those are the two churches. There was no rebuke. And one uniqueness that we see over here, the church who was going through persecution, there was no rebuke. So one way we can say that our brokenness, our troubles are good. That keeps us humble, that even keeps us holy in that matter, because when we shed tears in God's presence and we become focused to Him. Then we see the next church, the Pergamos church. That is a church, is a compromising church. They tolerate immorality, idolatry, and all kinds of heresies that comes along with that. The next church that we see, the church at Thyatira in chapter 2, verse 18, that was a corrupted church. It was a church who was entertaining the cultish teachings of a prophetess called Jezebel. So they are not willing to correct here. They yield to those kinds of teaching. Then we see, we learned once before from Sudeep, from the church at Sardis, that was a crippled church. It was a dead church. It has a reputation to be alive, but it is actually dead. It has no effect in the community because of that. That is what we see. Then we see the Philadelphia church. That church was a consistent church. They love each other and they do. Jesus says that I know your deeds. There was a church. It was a consistent church. Then we come to the Laodicean church. It was an indifferent, lukewarm church. So there was a, they lost the passion. So this can be, each one of us can be in any of these states. Maybe we may be careless, we may be, crushed, or we may be compromising, or we may be corrupt, or crippled, or we are consistent, or we become lukewarm or indifferent. That can be our own life also. This can be any area that we can be also. But the problem with this church is very simple that we see, is that they are, they lost the passion. And they lost that intimacy with Jesus. When we read the Bible, we see that the spiritual temperature is mentioned in various ways. Three different ways that we see. One of the commentators called Warren Wishby, this is what he says, the spiritual temperature of a Christian in three ways. One is, we read in Luke chapter 24, verse 32, there we see there is a burning heart. After the resurrection, Jesus was walking with the disciples to Emmaus. Remember that? They say that when he was explaining the word of God, our heart were burning within us. That is one way. That is the best place we should be actually. When we read God's word, when we hear God's word, when we study God's word, our heart is burning. That is one way. But Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 12, with one of the symptoms of the end time, our love become cold. We lose that enthusiasm to serve and to be in God's presence and do the things of God. Then we see the third kind of attitude is that we the lukewarm heart. They lost the passion for the Lord. This is, I just want to emphasize to follow what we studied yesterday evening again. God wants us to have an intimate relationship with God. That is what Christian faith is all about. Remember that. That is what God explained those things. God wants us to have an intimate relationship with Him. The metaphors Bible uses about this relationship is very interesting, very easy for us to picture in our mind. In John chapter 10, that we read, Jesus says, chapter 10, verse 11, we read that Jesus says that I am the good shepherd. So the relationship is like a shepherd and the sheep. But unfortunately, we may not get that picture because we don't come from that kind of background. We see only lamb in Costco, other than we don't see that at all. So sometimes it is hard to picture that maybe. But other relationship that the Bible says about is husband and wife, Valentine's Day, right? Husband and wife, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 to 32. All the husbands, you can memorize that scripture. All the wives are very happy today when I say that. Is there? Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 through 32. And this is the relationship that Christ and the church is like a husband and wife. All the husbands, you can read that actually. All the husbands read that. Right, let's read together that. Husbands, you are so weak. Read louder, please. Let them hear it. Yeah. It's nobody read. See? This is the problem. This is a family problem. See, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. And so that is, you know, we'll study about family life some other time. But we see that this is the relationship, the metaphor the Bible uses about is this. But it's a beautiful analogy that Paul brings that may be a little more passionate and meaningful in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 2. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 2. Look at that portion, the scripture. For I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy, for I betrothed to you one husband so that Christ I might present you as a pure virgin. Betrothed is also an old English actually. Engaged is maybe easy way for us to understand. Paul says that I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy, for I betrothed, I engaged you to one husband. But I am afraid that as a serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. So you get the metaphor in your mind now? So the biblical understanding of our relationship with God is not just go to a place and say something and just go back and do whatever we want to do. That is not what way it is. The Bible teaches about our relationship with God is like intimate, as we heard yesterday. You walk and talk and listen and communicate, and you know that as if you are going to take a ticket for other person. You are that real. That is what it is. That is what relationship the Bible is talking about. But that is what these people, you know, should have. But unfortunately, they lost it. You go through the scripture. You know, every person in the Bible, even we call the Old Covenant, Old Testament people, even they had this same kind of relationship. You know, examples after examples we can go. Abraham is known as the friend of God. Abraham is known as the friend of God. You know, but it happened automatically overnight, by the way. When you read the scripture, you all know this very well. You know, God called Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. What happened after that? The first thing he opened his mouth was a lie. That was Abraham. Call him God's friend. Then we see that he was afraid. God said, don't go back to Egypt. He took his wife, went there. You know, and he went through doubts, questions. He even questions the purposes of God many occasions. That is what he has done. But what happened later? This relationship was increasing, growing, developing. And there's a time comes, Abraham knows absolutely his friend so well. He has no doubt whatsoever at all. Abraham, we read, we talk about Enoch. Remember that Enoch in Genesis chapter 5, verse 22 through 24. Enoch walked with God. When he was 65 years old, he has Methuselah. And after he walked 300 years and he had other children. That is what the Holy Spirit says. That doesn't mean that in order to be close with God, you forsake everything and you go to a monastery and live there, pray all the time. That is the way you become a friend of God or become have that habitual fellowship with God. That is what the Bible says. What he has? He had other children. That means whenever he was living and leading a family life, still he was walking with the God. So this is not only for secluded, for a group of people. They can only develop this kind of intimacy with God. Rather, this can be for everyone. Enoch was a common man like you and me. But the uniqueness in that chapter, in the reign of death is this. But he walked with God. We talked about Moses in Exodus chapter 33. We'll come back to that chapter a little later. Exodus 33, there we read that as we said yesterday. Moses talked to God face to face. You underline that in your picture and you print it and put it somewhere else and see always Moses talked to God face to face. What a joyous thing. We read about David yesterday and today also again. David is known as the man after God's own heart. Man after God's own heart. Again, how it happened? It was not an overnight thing. We talk about Daniel. He is known as the man who found favor with God. Last several weeks ago, we talked about Paul. Paul's passion was to know Jesus. Look at all these people. All these people, Abraham, Enoch, Moses, David, Daniel, Paul. All these people. What is the common denominator? What is the common factor to all these people? Look at what happened to all these people. There we see that there was something in all of their lives is something unique is this. You know, the spiritual intimacy or being with God was their life objective. That was their life objective. It was not a casual thing for them. That was their life objective. Paul says, for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. Their desire was to know God. That was we learned yesterday. Remember that. It's not just casually I prayed, it is gone. I was reading a story about a father who sent his son to the bed, go and sleep at night. After 10, 15 minutes, he said, Dad. And Dad said, what? I need some water. He said, no, you had your chance. You can have water now. Go to bed. After 5 minutes later, he said, Dad. He said, what? And I need some water. He said, no, go to bed. If you don't go to bed, I will spank you if you call me one more time. After 5 minutes, boy called again, Dad, when you come to spank me, bring a cup of water also. That is what desire is. It will not go. It will not just go. These people are just casually say that, oh, I want to know God, send an email and done with that, 21 days fasting prayer and things over with that. That is not what it says. Look at this, all these people. Paul says that to live for Christ, I want to know Christ, Philippians 3:10. And Moses says in Exodus chapter 33, verse 13, he says, Lord, I want to know you. That was his desire. We read yesterday also in Psalms 27, verse 4. I want to see you. I want to seek your face. All these people, their life objective was to know God. Their desire was to know God. During this course of time, we said this. I just want to say one more time this. You can be as close as to God as you want to be. Did you hear me what I said? You can be as close as to God as you want to be. It is not your spouse's problem. It is not your children's problem. It is not your parents' problem. It is not your pastor's problem. It is not the church problem. It is not our environment problem. It is you, me. I can be as close as to God as I want to be because God is not going anywhere. You can come to him. The objective, the desire of these people, all of them were, they want to know God. So intimacy with God, this church lost it. The intimacy with God is a love relationship. The entire Christian journey, the spiritual journey, the spiritual life is not just some propositions, but having a passionate relationship with a person. Christian life is not just some believing some propositions, not changing from one to another, none of those things at all. It is a passionate relationship with a living person, Jesus Christ himself. That is what Christian life is all about. If we are not doing it, we are just playing games only. We need to understand that. We are just playing church only there. We are playing the churchianity. It is not Christianity then. So we just do it, go, come back. That's what it is. It is a desire. It is earnest desire of the people. The greatest commandment in the Bible. We read that the Pharisees came and asked Jesus this question, which is the great commandment? Jesus quote from Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 5. In Matthew chapter 22 verse 37. There we read that you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your spirit. So love is commanded there. It is not an option. It is not just an option. Loving means loving God. That is what God is calling us. That means, what is that then? We always say this, what is loving means. Loving God means there is no rivals in our heart then. There is no rivals in our heart. The other day we said that because when we love something else or someone else other than God or more than God, that is spiritual adultery. That is what we learned from Hosea. Remember that lesson that we learned? That spiritual adultery. Not only the Bible talk about that very well. In the Bible says that in James chapter 4, verse 3, 4 verse 4, that we read that loving the world is enemy to God. That is what it is. We become enemies of God. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, we see that if we love the world, the love of the Father is not in us. That's what it is. Not only that, remember, we just take our personal relationship. All the people who are married here, Valentine's Day again. How many of you are okay, your spouse will love someone else also? But he will take care of all your needs. He'll provide everything. He will send you all the things, buy you things, and everything is fine. But he loves someone else also. How many of you will be very happy about it? You'll shoot them, right? He will not be alive the next day morning at all. Period. That's it. There's not much of the spiritual talk here at all. right? You just imagine that. Actually. Somebody look at someone else, actually, man, you won't get dinner that day, right? So this, things are over. If you are that jealous about your personal relationship, what about God then? You read the scripture, what it says. We are engaged with Christ. So we are in love with him. So this is what God is talking about over here. So whatever that come without God, what happened then, or above God, that become an idol in our lives. Different kinds of idols we talk about. We don't have to go much of the details of it. But this is what the thrust of what we are trying to say. So God wants us to develop or wants us to have that spiritual intimacy with him at all the time. So spiritual intimacy, when we talk about the definition, we can say is this actually, it is the life of Christ produced in us by the power of the Holy Spirit. That is what intimacy is. It is the life of Christ produced in us through the power of the Holy Spirit. How that happened? When we abide in God's word. So the life of Christ produced in us by the power of the Holy Spirit as we abide in God's word. That is what intimacy simply means. You get that? That is what God is looking to these people. So this church, unfortunately, what happened? They lost that, and they lost that passion. God is asking them to come back to that. The Bible talk about our relationship again with God is always this: you are in me and I am in you. No, we are positionally, we are in Christ, and Christ is in us. Practically, that we explain and express it, we have to show that. You know, that is what God is calling us into this place. And if there is no intimacy with God, if we treat Christ as one of the guests at home, there is no intimacy at all. Remember that Paul was praying for the church at Ephesus. This was his prayer. You know, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17. Ephesians 3, 17, that's a long prayer. Then in between, you can see that one of the points of Paul's prayer is this. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17. He says that Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. Did you see that? Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. What is the difference there? You know, we people come our home. What happened then? They leave after some time. We know that they will leave after some time. Otherwise, we will give them signals. Please leave after some time, right? It says that, you know, guest and the fish will smell after 3 days. So it is better to leave before it starts smell. So we should be very courteous and very careful, you know, in this place, how we treat and deal things actually. So we know that they will go. So we are not bothered by many of the things. But somebody is going to come and stay there. How do you do then? You know, Blessy always like invite people home, not because, not only she love to see you, because I will clean the home that day. You know, so she says, come home today, actually. You know, we exercise today, you know. No. So we should know that, you know, things will be clean, you know. Why somebody come to stay then? How is then? It is little different then. So we have upstairs also to clean then. Otherwise, downstairs is enough, right? People go to upstairs, bathroom, we'll run after the bathroom is there. Don't go this side, actually. Because any closet you open, this will fall out. So we have to be very careful. So very careful where you open. So we walked with them, and this is the bathroom. They think that we are very courteous to them. No, don't open the other one. You will see all the skeleton there, right? What that tells us, practically I say this, but what that tells us then? Somebody going to stay little more cleaner then, right? Somebody goes to stay for a week. Oh, they will see. So all our real picture then, right? Until then, pastor is wonderful, but stay with me 1 week, you will see who I am then really. You get this? Paul was praying for the Ephesian churches. This was one of his prayer. Christ may dwell in us. You know, but later they forget about it. That is why the Holy Spirit later them, he lost the first love. Remember that? So what happened then? Intimacy with God will never happen if you treat Christ as a guest once in a week. We come to this place and see him. We are well dressed. We are nice. Everything is fine. How are you doing? We are so grateful. Thank you for everything you have done for last week. And we go. He leave him here. We don't want you to come with us then. That is then where the intimacy will develop. The intimacy will, you know, you look at our relationship with each other. How this happened. You know, I remember each of you come first time actually. You're very careful, you know, very scary, some of you actually. Who is this guy? What is happening over here? You know, after some time, what happened now? We become brothers and sisters. We become the part of the family of God. We know our, you know, our reactions, actions, everything. That took some time. This is what we talk about relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, they develop that intimacy with him. He dwell in us.
He lives with us at all times in our conversations, not only when we have a problem, that God is with us. God is with us always. Remember that. That is a comforting thought. That is a scary thought also. God is with us always. God has seen the disobedience of Achan among the millions of people. God has seen the tears of Hagar in the wilderness also. So that's both sides are there. So God sees us all the time. We see this is what we are looking into. So many a times we are not able to experience that kind of intimacy with God. It is not because of devil. Don't bother him all the time and don't give him all the credit either. Many of the problems that the hindrance to revival, the hindrance not we are having a relationship with Christ or cannot be developed an intimacy with God is because of, not because of devil, it is because of our own excuses. Our own excuses. We give more importance to many other things. I read, you know, somewhere else actually, I read a funny story. It says this, actually, one boy was writing answer to the question. You know, this is what he write. You know, the question was, what do you want to be? His answer was, I want to become a mobile phone. You know, that was the answer. Then he gives a reason for that. Because the mobile phone is the most important thing in our home. No matter what happens, the mobile phone, every time, my dad always on that actually. So he always look on that. Every time it goes on that actually. So, you know, all the importance, no matter what happens at home, when it rings, he run to that and take it actually. No matter what happens, more or less, most of the time, this is what, so I want to be a mobile phone. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? You all hear what I'm saying, right? This, I'm talking about myself. We talk about all of us. Sometimes we wean out these things actually. This become more important to us than anything else. I know that if I lose my phone, I will have a heart attack, right? Because something is going to happen in between this 1.5 hours that we sit here. We all think that actually what kind of things that comes in. So what is the hindrance that we are not growing in our relationship with God? Is America is a problem? Is that the problem? Look at all of us, actually, all the things that God has given to us. Is that the problem then? Remember that. That's not the problem. It is our own lame excuses. So how we grow up in the intimacy is a progressive process. It will not happen overnight in such a way. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, Peter says that, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But in that passage, in the 2 Peter, at least 3 or 4 times that Peter talked about, you know, diligence. Be diligent and disciplined to grow in the grace and knowledge of God. In order to grow in God, what we have to do then? We should have desire, as we learned yesterday. We should have that diligence. We should have that discipline. We should have humility to come before God. So that is what it is happening. So spiritual intimacy will never happen without that. So spiritual intimacy, the other thing is that it is not just duty. It is a devotion. It is a, not a duty, it is a devotion. So the demand that Christ gives in our heart is this, that we need to have that, to cultivate that intimacy with him. Cultivate that intimacy with him. Again, remember the scripture that tells us what? Christ is in us the hope of glory. You know, because I live, you also shall live. You in me and I in you. As Paul said, for me to live is Christ. These are the terminology that the Bible uses about it. So I just want to encourage you, don't stop here with a prayer. Oh, I prayed this many days. Don't stop there. We should continue this. This is a beginning. The God has sparked that fire in us. Now we have to continue that through our life. And we have to nurture it. And we have to develop that hunger to grow with him. And allowing God to dwell in us, and we have to be obedient to him. That is what God is looking into our lives. So it is a progressive process. Intimacy is a progressive process. It is internal than external many times. It is should be cultivated into our lives. But this church, the Laodicean church, unfortunately, they lost all those things. And what is their problem? What is the danger of being indifferent? Look at that verse over there. What happened to these people? So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind and naked. What happened to these people? The danger of being indifferent. They are not realizing their need. They are not realizing their need. They think that they are rich. They are content with everything that they have. I very humbly, I want to tell you this actually. Remember, activity is not equal to productivity. Activity is not equal to productivity. You know, so many things are going on, that doesn't mean that something produced that. You know, some commotions are not equal to progress. And another dangerous thing, remember that blessings is not confused with the blessings and the presence of God. Sometimes you may think that you are blessed, but that doesn't mean that God's presence is with us. Because the Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, God sent rain upon the righteous and the wicked. God rises sun over the righteous and the wicked. So don't think that, you know, if you have, that is the case, Ambani is blessed, you know, Microsoft is blessed, everybody is blessed in that matter. So don't just confuse with the blessings with the presence of God. I will show you an example that we read in Exodus chapter 33 again, one of my favorite text. You know, read Exodus chapter 33. You know, God says to Moses this, that is the context of that entire chapter, Exodus chapter 33. God says to verses 1 through 3, Exodus chapter 33, verses 1 to 3. I just want you to look at the scripture. I don't want to explain much of it actually. This is God says to Moses. God says, leave this place, and what you do? You and the people you brought up out of Egypt, and go up to the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give to your descendants. I will send an angel before you and drive out the Canaanites, Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Hivites, Jebusites, and go up to the land flowing with the milk and honey, but I will not go with you, because you are a stiff-necked people, and I may destroy you on the way. You see what are the things that God says there? God says, I will give the land with milk and honey. I will destroy all the enemies before you. I will give you the protection. I will give you all these things. But one thing, I don't want to come with you. Do you read that? So sometimes, so you can be, even in the promised land, maybe you think that God has given to us, but God is not there. You get that? This is scary part of it, I believe. Don't misunderstand blessings with the presence of God. I got a lot of things doesn't mean that God has blessed us. If you work very well, you do things proper way, you can make money, you can be blessed also. You do the marketing very well, you can attract people also towards all these things. So that doesn't mean that this is all God's presence over there. That in that context, Moses prayed, Lord, don't leave us, don't let us go if you are not coming with us. So this is the warning that we have to get as a church. Lot of things are going on doesn't mean that God is there. We are doing so many things because of our own self-actualization doesn't mean that that is ministry. That's not what it is. We need to understand that this is, if God is not going with us, if God's presence is not with us, none of those things has no meaning whatsoever at all. The church at Laodicea, they say that we are rich. What is the problem here? We have programs, we have procedures, we have fund, we have money, we have all the things are going good for us. We have people are coming and going, all kinds of things are happening. That is what they are talking about. They have no problem whatsoever at all. They are not recognizing that what is the need over there. So Moses prayed that prayer, that beautiful prayer in chapter 33, verse 16. Lord, we need you. We need you. So this is what intimacy, that is in the context that we read. Moses talked to God face to face. In chapter 33, I think verse 10 or onwards, we read that actually there is another picture also we can see over there. The difference between the people and Moses and Joshua. In chapter 10, 33, verses 10 onwards, Lord will speak to Moses face to face as a man speaks with his friends. Then Moses will return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. So a couple of verses prior to that, there is, it says that the people stand at their doorsteps and watch this. You know, you see that Moses went out of the tent, all the people rose and stood at the entrance of where? Read this. Whose tent? Their own tents. What are they doing? They're looking actually, oh, Moses' face, look at that actually. His face is so radiant. That's wonderful, wonderful happened. You know, what are they doing? They are not willing to leave their tents to be in God's tent. But look at about Joshua later we read. Joshua doesn't want to leave God's tent at all. No wonder Joshua became the leader, took these people to the promised land. Even Moses couldn't accomplish it. Right? Don't misunderstand with the blessings with the presence of God. That is a warning I believe that God is giving to us. Remember that. So we, no matter what happened to us, as we learn yesterday, if I live only one more day, I want to have God with me. That should be our hunger and prayer. Psalms 85 verse 6, another text that we used to read and study about revival. There it says, we say that, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? That is emphasis over there. That the people may rejoice not in your gifts, but rejoice in you. These people says that they are not realizing what they really need. The second problem when we become indifferent is this. What happened? They become self-sufficient. You can underline that scripture over there. It says that don't need a thing. Don't need a thing. You know, you ever see this among us sometimes? Among our children, our own life sometimes? What else we need? We don't need a thing actually. When we have money, we have a credit card. When you are sick, the ambulance is available. You know, you don't have to talk to anybody anymore. You can leave even without leaving your own home. You know, the Amazon drone will drop you everything on your doorstep. You don't have to even leave your home. We don't need anybody, anything at all. But remember that one thing that we need, or one person that we cannot live without, is God himself. You know, we cannot live without God. You know, because God doesn't need us, by the way. God doesn't need you and me to do this. You know, God doesn't need you and me to tell him about his worth or to praise him or worship him. God doesn't need any of us at all. God can live without all these things. But remember that we need him desperately. We need him desperately. Without him, we cannot live at all. Now, there is a man called Aidan Wilson Tozer, A.W. Tozer. You heard about him. When he was a 15-year-old young boy, he was a worker. He was an employee in a tire factory. On the way, he was walking home one day. He heard a street preacher preaching, if you don't know how to be saved, just call on God. That, you know, ring in his ears. When he went home, he started to pray, the Lord, I want to know you. I want to know you. That was the pursuit of his life. He started to pray. He didn't have any formal theological education. That hunger, that pursuit led him. He is known as one of the greatest prophet of the last century. Even still he minister. You know, one of his books, every Christian should read that. Make sure you will read. If you haven't read that, you read that. The Pursuit of God. The Pursuit of God. The other book is The Knowledge of the Holy. In Knowledge of the Holy, he said this. You know, when what comes into your mind when you think about God, that is the most important thing about you. What comes into your mind when we think about God, that is the most important thing about you. What comes into your mind when we think about God? What comes into your mind? And he wrote extensively that subject over there. He says that no world, no nation will rise above its religion and concept and idea about God. Now that is a important task. We have to understand that. We are living in a world, people say that there is no need of God. I have everything. Why I have to serve God? I have to worship God. Why I have to pray? Why I need to go to church? I work hard. I have all these things. Then why I need God in my life? People ask that question. You know, those who are not willing to read, actually, there is a book by Ravi Sakriya, says, Can Man Live Without God? There is a good book to read. So you don't like to read. There is a sermon that he preached about that, actually, need God, what if I don't need? That is on YouTube, actually. You can Google that and listen to that. Why we need God? Why we need God? Without God, we cannot exist at all. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, the Bible says this, God has put eternity into our heart. One of the theologians says that until we find rest in God, we become restless always. You see that people live in the world. They have everything. But at the end of the day, that is emptiness. The richest man, the wisest man who lived, Solomon, he wrote and he said, vanity and vanity and vanity is of vanity. Everything is empty. Everything is futile. He had fame, he had money, he had everything. But at the end of the day, he says that, look at all those things, all the end of all these pursuits is just emptiness. That's what it is. Remember that God has created you and me to have that intimate relationship with him. If you don't have that relationship, it is God is inviting us to do that. That is what God is looking for. It is not about all the things that we have, but we need him. The people, those who have found that, understood that, they start to pray in such a way, whom I have in heaven other than you. He is, that person says that I am not just going to heaven to avoid hell. Rather, I want to be in heaven because God is there. I want to be with him. That is the desire. That is the hunger. That is what we need. The people don't realize that. Why this? Because this church, they had everything and they think that they have everything. But what happened then? No, the God is talking to them over there. We see. Look at that. Jesus reveals the true condition of that church. Jesus tells them, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. When we talk about evil, evil is always out there, right? We talk about out there somewhere else. But when Jesus looks, evil is not there, evil is here. Evil is in us. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 19, we read that Jesus says, for out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. These are what defiles a person. But eating with unwashed hands does not defile them. Where is evil? Evil is not out there. Evil is in us itself. Who says this? The one who look at with x-ray eyes and looking deep into the heart. This church says that we don't need a thing whatsoever at all. We have everything. We are rich. We have good programs. We have big building. We have enough fund. We have all the things that we needed. But God look at the heart and say, no, you don't realize what you are missing, what you don't have it. So don't misunderstand with the commotion, with the voices, with other things about the presence of God. We have to come back to that and to be open and honest before God as God is, Christ is inviting us to do. And Jesus is giving them the advice to these people, the promise to them. What are the promise? Jesus says to them, verse 18, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire. So value what is valuable. Value what is valuable. Then he says that you buy, so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness. The emperor is naked, but they are not recognizing it. Christ says that your good works, your efforts, or your programs, none of those things will not make you righteous. As we said the other day, things we do for the Lord will not make us holy. But God says that you have to clothe the righteousness. You have to clothe yourself with the righteousness. Remember this. This is one thing I want you to take your heart before you go. Remember that we not only need forgiveness to go to heaven, we need holiness also. We not only need forgiveness to go to heaven, we need holiness. Without holiness, we cannot see God. Jesus said, those who are pure in heart, they will see God. Those who are pure in heart, they shall see God. Remember that. We know not only just forgiveness, I have a ticket, I am ready to go. No, this is an ongoing thing. You know, we have to walk in holiness. We have to obey. We have to walk with him. We are willing to walk and obey with him. That is what God is requiring from us. So not only forgiveness, we need holiness. When we come closer to the presence of God, this is what happens. This is the result of it that we see. And God says to them, so you can cover your shameful nakedness. The third thing, and salt to put on your eyes so you can see. So you will have a new perspective. Value what is valuable. Clothe yourself with righteousness. And not only that, to have a valuable, have a new perspective. We'll conclude because time is up. We'll see then what happened then. What is a promise or what is a result of a revival? It's another subject we can study. But these verses, let's read and finish here. Verse 19. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. That is what the other days always I was saying that. And when you, each time when you come, don't think that, oh, I didn't get a comforting sermon today, so I get miserable. No. If God, you believe that God spoke to you, there is a correction that means that God loves you. So thank God for that. God is calling us for repentance, to confession, like David. You know, then God loves us. That's why God sent the prophet. Otherwise, they are gone, right? So God loves us. God says his people, I don't want you to condemn you and throw you away. Rather, I love you. That is why I discipline you. So the things I say that may offend you, and I am not an angry pastor, by the way. But the thing is that it is a part of the job. You know, father sometimes have to correct. That is part of it. So if you are offended, I am very glad about it only. I will never get sad about it. It is part of it. Because that means God speaks to our hearts. God disciplines us. So be earnest and repent. And here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Usually we use this text for salvation. You know, people tell that God, Jesus is knocking at your door. No, just knocking at somebody's door out there. Jesus knocking at the door of the church actually. And you wonder actually, what is church by the way? Church by definition is about Christ, right? Church by definition is the called out people by Christ to worship him, to follow him and walk with him. That is what church is. But where is Christ is now? Christ is outside. That's what in other days he was saying actually. Tozer said, if the Holy Spirit is taken from us, from the church, 95% of the people or the churches in the world will never know what happened at all. They will continue as it is. Even if the rapture happened, the church will have multi-site and all kinds of things happen. Nobody will know actually. They will have a lot of programs. Nobody will worry. Where is Christ? Christ is outside. He's knocking at the door of his church because they don't want him. They don't want him. That can be personal level also. But the beauty of that promise is this. If anyone open, I will have communion with him. This is what those who pray earnestly, the importance of it. We can look around and say that, oh, there was not people, nobody came, and why all those things? We can say, no, that's okay. But you open. One person is willing to pray. Two people prayed, revival happened. One person willing to pray and pray, what happened? God says, I will come. I will with communion with you. So this is what happened. The result of revival is an earnest hunger for the presence of God. No, you know, they will miss it. Look at this church actually. The church is meeting, they are doing all those things. They think that they are rich and they are saturated and complacent with everything. Not even recognizing that Christ is not there. See, they may be singing about Christ. They are worshipping Christ. Doing all those things. But only problem is Christ is not there at all. But they never miss that at all. What a tragedy then, right? What a tragedy. Do you miss God? Do you know that? You know, God's presence, as we learned yesterday also, David prayed that, Lord, do not cast me from your presence. That is what make me more sad. And that is what may break me. Do not take me from your presence. Do not take me from your presence. You know, have that hunger to be in the presence of God. That is the result of the revival. That is what God is inviting all of us. The love for the presence of God. Verse 21, to him who overcomes, I will give the right. Every church, this was the challenge. Not to survive, but to overcome. I was a youth worker when I started as a ministry when I was young, actually. You know, you know, so you know, I was the state secretary for those things, actually. There are 1,600 different chapters to that organization. I travel all over the places and go do these things, actually. And the Sunday school, you know, anniversary was one of my major ministry opportunity, actually. So you go. There are two kinds of prizes to give to people. One prize is that everybody, those who win, the things, you know, the context of singing or, you know, memory verses, those kinds of things. Then finally, there is another kind of prize, just to have to encouraging prize, you know. They didn't do anything at all, just to, what is the English word, I don't know, prolsayana sammanam, you know. That means actually, consolation. Consolation, right word, you know. So he didn't win, but to console him. There is no consolation prize in heaven, by the way. You know, we used to go to the church and we say nice two things, and also after all these years, we got a consolation prize. No, those who overcome. You want to be an overcomer? That is what God is calling us. You want to be an overcomer, victory over sin. Those who have victory over sin, what is the result, promise that God gives? Look at that verse, it says, to him who overcomes, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne. Just as I overcome. You get the authority. Everybody want authority, right? We love to see that, you know, we can exercise authority, you know. I know, sorry, the time is up, but this comes in my mind, actually. I have a You know that I have Alexis, you know. And you ask her, how old are you? She says, six. I don't know what she meant by the, you know, six or how old are you. I don't understand at all. But her passion is to control Jaden. That is what it is. Even in night, day, or any time, she want to, you know, overpower upon him. And somehow, you know, get up in the morning, first thing that she want to do, even at night when he's sleeping, wake up and pinch him and do all kinds of things, control him. We all want to exercise authority. But there is a price to pay. What is the price? Overcome sin. Overcome sin. That is what God is calling us to do. So I pray that these 21 days will not go in vain. God spoke to us every day. Every day. We heard God speak to our hearts. This even this morning, we will finish here. I just want to encourage you. If our life is, our family, our church is like the Laodicean church. We assume that God is with us. It is like Jesus' parents, after 2 days, they didn't recognize that he was not with him. It is child abuse, actually, modern days. They should have been arrested. They couldn't recognize the child is not with him. You are walking in the journey, thinking, assuming, imagining that God is with you. You may be singing, doing all kinds of things. You think that you are doing it for the Lord, but you don't have a relationship with him. There are professional singers out there. Chitra, Yesudas, the name is and all. You sing for Sabarimala and for Christ at the same day, no problem. One recording studio to another. The songs they sing is beautiful and marvelous. You have tears when you hear that. But they don't even know who this Christ is they are singing of. What a tragedy then. So don't miss that. This morning, we are going to pray. You know, spiritual life is, or Christian life, or Christian faith is very simple. It is not about propositions. It is about a person. It is about a relationship with Jesus Christ. So if you don't have that, you can start it today. If you have that, if you are growing in that, you can make a decision today. You know, that is what we do. I will finish here and praying because the time is up. But this is the cry of the Holy Spirit to all of us. Would you please pray?